Oh yeah, check out Growing Your Greens hats, now available. Compassion-tees.com. Limited time only. Tucson, Mike Gomez. You're hotter than I am, man. What's growing in your garden? Let's see here. North Carolina, how do you keep the aphids off your kale? I do have aphids early season. Actually, I haven't had aphids like any major aphids. The last aphids I've seen on my peppers, but like springtime I get a lot of aphids. Right now I really haven't. I don't know why that is. I haven't sprayed any toxic, persistent, even organic pest control in my garden this year. I released like 2 rounds of praying mantis eggs. So basically every raised bed got like 1 egg sack, which could lay up to 100 praying mantis. So I don't know if that has something to do with it. The other thing that I'll do is like almost every night I'm out spraying down the plants. So plants do have like, I'm mostly having whiteflies right now on my tree collards. I spray them off every night and I'm out there every night. If they reappear the next day, I spray them off the next night, and just doing that consistently, and I guess the key word is consistently, they seem to be less of a problem, plus along with the praying mantis. Oh, and the other thing, I'll make a video about this, is actually ladybugs. I have so many ladybugs in my garden this year, like I've never had before. And that's because I let my cilantro go to seed, and they laid so many eggs in there. And actually, I'm looking at my dill. Well, my dill yesterday had so many different ladybug, egg things or whatever, and the little creatures were hatching. So I have had a big increase in ladybug population, not because I released them. Don't spend your money on ladybugs. That's a bad, bad, bad idea. But they just came naturally because I had some of the attractant plants and I had bugs here for them to feast on. So they came. So that was really cool. All right, so let's see here. And then grow high quality plants, super important. All right, let's see here. Where are you located? I'm in Las Vegas, Nevada. Hello from Maine. How's your mushroom plant doing? Oh, the rungia, yeah. So the rungia I planted out in the garden, you know, that got hit by the frost, croaked, right? I did keep some rungia growing in my flood table in the back, actually unprotected over the winter. It's kind of looking a little bit jacked up, but it survived the winter and it's coming back now that the weather's warming up. And then I have some rungia in the in my greenhouse that's unheated, and the water comes on every day, and actually that's doing the best in there. So it's not even like full sun. Aloha from beautiful Oahu. I wish I was there. Oh man, it's only 100 here. Yeah, well it's 107 here maybe. Probably gonna get it warmer because it's not quite the peak of the day yet. Let's see here. What's up from Pennsylvania? Probably a lot cooler there. We've been watching you forever. Love it. One love family. Let's see. Go down on the comments here. Oh, yeah. So can somebody, oh, yeah. Lots of questions coming in. Oh, my God. I'm getting flooded now. Can somebody send me the link over the chat for this session on YouTube Live? I'd appreciate it, and I'll give you a shout out. Let's see here. So, hello from London. Trying to make my way down the comments to get to the current ones. You prefer shade for them? Not sure the question. Let's see. Yeah, John Kohler Live, really rare. Ireland, oh my God, all the way around the world, but it's cooler there. I'm a huge fan and have become so inspired by you and have a food forest going thanks to you, Deborah Peoples. Awesome, Deborah. I'm glad I could inspire. Queensland, maybe I'll move to Australia one day, but I'm not sure. I got to visit there first. What's up from Houston? That's a nice place. They got that good nursery down there that I like. Arizona. How to make moonshine, bro. Yeah, I don't make moonshine. I have overly fermented kombucha in alcohol. And it's easier to ferment fruit juice in alcohol. But I don't do it. Let's see. Hat is awesome. Love the t-shirt. Got two in the mail. Awesome. Glad you're liking the t-shirts. Won't let non-mods post links. Ah, won't let non-mods. That sucks, man. YouTube freaking sucks. Let's see here. Okay, let's keep going. Let's see. Raining crazy in Baltimore? Are you kidding me, man? It's so crazy. Like, I travel a lot. Usually, like, I travel on the weekends. I'm home during the week. And, like, trips me out to go to a different place where the weather's totally different. You know, when I get on the plane, like, I barely take, like, jackets or coats or, like, I don't take sweatshirts or anything because it's so hot. And then I get to where we're going, I'm freaking freezing my butt off from getting rained on without proper attire. It's just like a different world. Let's see, hello from Fort Myers. Let's see here. Keep going down. My strawberry plants are skimpy and the berries are tiny. Help. Yeah, I don't know. It depends where you live. I mean, if they're skimpy and tiny berries, maybe you need some nutrition in your soil. Phoenix here, my peach trees are doing great. Love the hat. Yeah, the cool thing about the hat, made in America. All right. Let's see. I'm still trying to get that stupid link to share this on Facebook since it's rare I go live. I don't even know how to get the live link. That's so lame. Let's see here. Oh, I see. You got it. I got the link. Oh, no, wait. Is that... No, that's the server encoder setup. Oh, here. Share. Oh, view on watch page. All right. All right. Well, that was easy. Okay. Good deal. Got that. Man, I'm sweating. Okay, perfect. Share that. Close that. Oops, gotta get in here. Thank God. All right, that's posted. All right, cool. All right, a little bit of housekeeping stuff. Now I'm back for sure. Let's see how we're looking. 153 people watching. All right, let's go down. Oh my God, I'm getting inundated with all kinds of questions. Why are my tomatoes so dry this summer? That's a good question. I mean, my tomatoes, depending, like I've tomatoes planted in different areas in different soils. Some are doing better than others. Like I planted some in the raised beds. And those are like 6 feet tall now. They have regular deep watering. And then I hit them every night. And then I planted some like super extra deep where I know there's probably not getting water super deep. So I try to water them deep. I notice the days that I water them really deeply, they get water, they're happier. And if they just get shallow watering, they're not so happy. So make sure you water your tomatoes like deeply. And I prefer to do them less frequently than more frequently. But you know, it's hot. I mean, I don't know if you can see the beads of sweat running down my face. But I mean, it's 107 degrees here today. And luckily when we get hot, you could put a hat on, you could go inside. Plants, they don't have legs, they can't move. So, you know, and the other thing too is super important is you wanna get them established and acclimated to the climate for early, you know? So I planted these guys not in the peak of 100 degree weather. These guys got planted out in late April, before it got really hot. So they kind of like been growing in place, setting their roots down and kind of like slowly acclimating to the weather, which is super important. You know, I mean, if you're just thrown into like, you know, a frying pan, it's hardcore, but if you're put in the frying pan and then the heat builds up slowly, you're not gonna notice it. It's kind of like that frog thing. But, and same with your plants, right? If the plants get shocked into hot temperatures one day, then they're not gonna be able to handle it. But if it slowly grows over time and the heat keeps getting a little bit hotter, they're already situated, they're already established, they're already used to the temperature fluctuations, they're already making some of the different compounds and chemicals and whatever within them to basically give them heat protection. So plants are amazing. Yeah, do you have shade cloth above you all summer or just mid? Yes, so I'm gonna make a video on this shade cloth. Actually, I put this new shade cloth up maybe like 2 weeks ago. And oh my God, it's like the best shade cloth ever. So last year I used black shade cloth 40%. This year I got actually aluminate shade cloth 40%. And I like it better, but also I could tell my plants like it better. I mean, my plants just seem a lot more happy and healthy because of that. I mean, I don't normally recommend, and you know, shade cloth is a weird thing. It's like people think either you're for shade cloth and you're going to do it or you're against it. I'm kind of like halfway in the middle, right? Like I'd love to just do shade cloth like in the midday, right? You know, in the morning, the sun's out, it's cool, it's great. The heat's not super intense. I'd keep the shade cloth off, right? End of the day, the sun starts going down, sun starts setting. Hey, full sun is great and all that stuff. But the midday, especially here in Vegas, maybe other hot climates, you know, that being said, I think most of the country probably you don't need shade cloth and you're wasting your money. But where it's super extreme hot in the summer, you know, I think it can be helpful for sure. Especially, it'll allow you to grow a wider mixture of plants that you wouldn't normally be able to grow without it, right? Because this just basically helps to temper some of the intense, you know, ultraviolet radiation and also keeps a little bit cooler. I think for me mostly though, it's about the heat and the solar radiation. And so that's why the aluminette basically, because it's like reflective, it reflects some of that back up. So I'm gonna do a video where I'm gonna test the temperature, like not under my shade cloth, and then under my shade cloth. And then not only am I gonna test the temperature, I'm gonna test the light. So I have a light meter. We're gonna test the light outside the shade cloth and then underneath it. And I mean, just to work out in the garden, the shade cloth, just for me to work in the garden, makes it so much easier and nicer. I mean, yeah, it's still 107 out degrees, but I don't mind working out underneath the shade cloth if I wasn't under the shade cloth. And whether I'm under the shade cloth or not, I'm still wearing a hat. I mean, it just makes it a lot more pleasant, and I think my plants are having a better time. And actually, these peppers, well, you guys can't really see these here. Let me see if I could even show you these guys. Show you. Yeah, so these guys right here, the peppers all along here, have been under shade pretty much most of their lives. And these peppers are actually doing the best out of any of the peppers I'm growing this year. Some of the other ones that didn't have as much shade in the beginning, when it started getting over 100 degrees, didn't quite do as well or perform as well. So, and then also my yields too. So, I mean, I have increased my fertility practices. I'm much more up on the compost, TN, and adding different kelp and Neutrogen, you know, foliar feeds this year than normal. So I will say that helps, but I think also the shade helps a lot too, because before I put the shade up, these guys would wilt midday, and now they're actually not wilting midday, which I think is super important. You know, the more the plants are stressed out, the less it's going to be able to grow and fruit for you. Oh, the other thing, I was getting like burn. So I was getting burn on some of the fruits from sunburn, and now with the shade cloth up, I'm not getting sunburn. But that being said, you know, if I had more labor and it's just me, or if I had some kind of electronic contraption that was cheap to basically take the shade off, you know, and put it on, I would once again just put it on in the midday heat, take it off in the morning and in the evening. That being said, there's just me, and putting all the shade cloth up was, you know, it took a good couple hours. So it's not about to come down every day just so I could shade my plants. So I'm just leaving it up all the time. So that's my opinion on that. Let's get back to some of the questions here. Let's see here. So shade cloth up all summer. Yeah, so I mean, it's pretty much up all summer until the weather cools down a little bit and I feel that it's good. How do you get rid of powder mildew, not just wash it off? Yeah, powdery mildew. So change the pH. You know, you could do that with milk. They say... they also have a bacteria on there, or bacteria you could buy to basically, that'll kick ass on the powdery mildew, which is a fungus. I forget the brand name. Let's see. And then, oh, the other thing for powdery mildew is try to change your practices, right? Like, I don't like to overhead water or get water on the leaves of my plants, because you're just going to attract that. Of course, you might live in a climate that's really humid, where it's going to be a lot more challenging to get rid of the powdery mildew. If it's small affected areas of powdery mildew, I just basically clip off all the leaves and take them and compost them offsite and get them out of here. So hopefully you could control it by plucking leaves. Because once you got it, I mean, you're kind of fighting an uphill battle. And if the plants aren't really producing and making a lot, it might be good to just pull them. I mean, it just depends on you. Let's see here. San Antonio, Texas. I haven't been to San Antonio in quite a while. Let's see, 189 people watching. My laptop is getting extremely hot in the sun. The rains haven't been good for my containers in the container or strawberry in the ground from Chris Hansen. Let's see. I don't really have an easy way to like scroll through comments. Oh my God, let's see here. Actually, I think my trackpad is no longer working because it's so hot. This is crazy. Yeah. There we go. Oh, somebody asked, are you spraying with just water or neem and soap at night? So just water. So actually, I haven't used any neem and soap at night. This is going back to the question of how do I treat for my white flies. So neem and soap, even though it's organic and even though I have videos on it in the past, you know, I'm trying to take it to the next level, and I want you guys to take it to the next level if you feel that you could do that, right? Neem and soap is a persistent organic pesticide, basically. I mean, it'll kill the plants or kill bugs on the plants when it hits, and because it's an oil and not just a soap, it's going to stick around. So that it may also harm some of the beneficials. As you guys saw, my last episode was on beneficials. I'm posting a new video tonight on how to track native bees, which are the most important pollinators, even over and above honeybees, to your garden. And the neem and soap, you know, in my opinion, I think that can affect beneficials, so I want to not spray that unless absolutely necessary. Of course, if I have a really bad outbreak and I'm gonna lose crops and I don't want to sit there and press and squeeze all the bugs and all this stuff so that they don't eat my stuff, or and spraying water on them doesn't work, or spraying some other lighter duty spray doesn't work, like I would do like water first. Then I got this new thing called Dr. Zymes. That's a non-long-lasting pesticide that breaks down chitin. That dissipates pretty quickly, and as it, once it gets dry, it's no longer effective. And so then that's the next step. So I have used that this year. The next step might be like soapy water. You know, soapy water, yeah, that'll clog them up, clog up their cells. If they gets in there, it's gonna maybe leave a little bit of coating on the plant, but that's like relatively low risk. But once you start getting into oils, you know, I just don't wanna like try to hurt other non-target creatures, actually. Let's see here. Sorry, I can't get to every question and I'm still like halfway down on the comments. Let's see here. I could probably make the same logo on a custom t-shirt for cheaper. All right, Chris. Okay, let's see here. Good morning from sunny Brisbane. Hey, I'm trying out Coast of Maine lobster compost for the first time. Have you ever tried it before? I'm not on that coast. I have not. It sounds interesting, though. I'd like to see what's in there. Oh my God, let's see. Now the problem is, my trackpad's not super responding and I can't see all the chats coming in. Let's see, what can I do here? Oh, pop out chat. Jeez. Here, let's give you guys a shot, a little more of the garden there. And if the pop out chat ever comes up, all right, here we go. Are you growing perennial asparagus broccoli? No. Honolulu, Hawaii, cool. I love the weather in Hawaii. The bugs in Florida just laughed at me when I tried neem soap. How is your freeze dryer? It's awesome. Oh my God, I'm freeze drying so many crazy things. I'm gonna have an episode on it soon, so stay tuned. It's like the best, I mean, yeah, it was expensive, but it's the best kitchen gadget I bought or have gotten in a long time. That what you could do with it is completely amazing. Actually, I have someone new flowering, like top flowering basil right now. I'm gonna just top them all and then just pile them in the freeze dryer and freeze dry it and then store it. So then I could have basically my own freeze dried basil in the winter. And there's really no other way to preserve the good flavors of basil without literally freeze drying it. Let's see, Manitoba, Canada. Let's see, love the stream, please get more familiar as I will join all the time. Don't forget to toggle top chat to live chat. Oh, I don't know how to do that. Okay, let's see, top chat, oh, live chat. Oh, okay, got it. Yeah, live chat, I got live chat, thanks, Candy. Hi from London, love your composting episodes, cool. Oh man, I got some cool composting episode coming up hopefully. How would you get rid of fungus gnats? I mean, mainly change the environment. If you got a lot of fungus gnats, it's like overwatering. You could also try to put like a couple of layers of inches of sand on the top so that they don't have like a nice medium to basically egg in. There's also beneficial nematodes that'll kick ass over fungus gnats. There's also, if you go to the store, I'm looking at mine right now, they're called mosquito bits, and the mosquito bits are good for mosquitoes. They're basically like a bacteria. And it says on the package, good for, mosquitoes and fungus gnats. So this little bacteria that'll eat their eggs or something. Let's see. Put tomatoes in brown paper bag to ripen them faster. What organic pest control do you use? So this year I've been using mostly water. The other thing I've been doing actually is I try to grow high quality plants that basically don't like to have bugs. Other pest control I like to, actually this year I've been really up on, after visiting Rincon Vitova, check those episodes out if you haven't already, releasing predatory or beneficial insects. So I have released, I put out over 50 praying mantis eggs. So I have all little praying mantises going around, which are my labor force. They're eating the bad bugs for me, so I don't have to spray. I think that's a lot more better approach. The other thing I'm doing is I'm planting a lot more herb style plants that are going to attract the beneficial pollinators and also some of the beneficial insects. I have had some episodes on this before. I've been spraying just only water. And let me get the other thing I've been using actually this year. The other thing I've been using is this stuff right here. It's actually called a Dr. Zymes, and it's an eliminator, all natural insecticide and fungicide. And I just got samples. So my tests are not conclusive on this, so I don't really have an episode on this yet. I need to test this more before I fully make a video about it. But I'm using it and testing it. I think it works, but I need to get more to test it to be sure. But this is really cool because, this is like, it's probably like, I'd probably go like, if I am spraying something, I spray water to spray off the bugs. Also, of course, I use my fingers to, pinch bugs, smush them. I just stepped on a bug actually just now. That was a bad bug. But this guy, basically, you dilute this mixture with 32 ounces of water. So 2 ounces of this with 30 ounces of water. So you make 32 ounces. Then I spray it. And basically what it is, I'm told, is that it's some enzymes. So it's like some chitinase enzymes or some other enzymes that basically break down the chitin shell of soft-bodied insects, so they're going to croak. Also, some of the enzymes may eat funguses and all these other things. I'm not exactly really sure on how that works. But then the thing is, once you got to not do this in the sun. So don't spray it in the sun. You got to spray it at night, in the evening, after the sun's down. And then it only works while the water is wet. Water is always wet, right? So anyways, once the water evaporates off, the enzymes in here no longer work. So pretty much, if you spray it on some bugs or pests, they're gone. Now, the cool thing is, this works on spider mites. And, spider mites are, you could spray neem and Dr. Bronzo on spider mites to kill them, but the problem is the spider mite eggs are resistant to neem. But this guy will supposedly get the spider mite eggs because this will break down what the spider mite eggs are made of. So that's really cool. So I'm kind of excited about this. I have to do more testing. I have to actually get more first. What temperature is it there? Well, I have the, you guys can see that there, my thermometer on the wall. It's like 107, so I'm sweating a storm up here. Let's see, can you roll a meme in one hand? I have no idea what that is. Eat the bugs. Yes, many bugs are edible. I do have a lot of roly-poly bugs, and actually they are related to crustaceans. Now, if we have the zombie apocalypse and my garden, I have no greenery in my garden, and I only have those roly-poly bugs, I'd eat those guys, because I grew them, because they're actually eating all my decaying matter in my garden. That being said, as long as there's green, I'm not eating roly-poly bugs. Thank you very much. What about diatomaceous earth, John? Yeah, so I've been ranting about non-toxic ways to control pests. You know, diatomaceous earth, everything has its pros and cons, right? I mean, that, I believe, could also negatively impact, you know, beneficial bugs. It's probably, like, less harmful to the environment, but the problem is, on the diatomaceous earth, if you're not putting it in water and then spraying it on, it could be quite harmful to us because of the fine particulates, so that's definitely not fun. Squirrels. I've no idea. I don't have squirrels. So, I have plenty of seeds. We'll plant them even though it's hard to get them to germinate this late. So hot and usually dry. Yeah, so, I mean, honestly, a lot of my seeds I just throw out. So, I don't, you guys could see, like, here down below. You guys could see, like, I have all the pepper plants. I have some cool melons. And then down below, I just have, like, everywhere is filled in with purslane, which I didn't plant. And so, it's all kinds of good stuff. Let's see here. We live in Asia. We live crispy fried crickets. I think they love crispy fried crickets. What about controlling roaches? Yeah, that's a good question. So, for roaches, I've been using, so I had on one of my episodes, it's actually a roach control, or was that an ant control? I mean, basically, in the roaches, like, when I see them, I might get them, but I think they're just part of the ecosystem. I mean, unless they're, like, on some of my plants, like, eating some of the leaves, which gets kind of gross. Luckily, I've controlled most of the cockroaches. Like, I go to the homes where they live, which they live in my irrigation boxes, and I just basically put, like, a boric acid mixture in there, and actually that's good for the diatomaceous earth, so that you're not providing them a home. Can we get a walkthrough? Yeah, so a walkthrough is coming. I'm gonna do a walkthrough tour video really soon, but right now I'm attached with an Ethernet cable and plugged in to the wall, so, because I'm on my laptop. Let's see. Ryan Cotter asks, bong rips or joints? Neither. Juice it and watch my video on juicing cannabis. Have you grown cuttings in tissue cultures? No, it sounds really interesting and I'd love to do that one day. Move out of the hood. Keep your house clean. advice for growing Janeiro in Zone 5, Fort Collins, Colorado. Yeah, so my Janeiro, you guys can't see it, but we're talking Janeiro Procumbens have grown so well this year. So Fort Collins, Janeiro is cool because it's like a perennial vegetable, and it could survive like high 30s and even like 35 degrees. It kind of hangs out. Some things like Moringa and other more tropical plants like don't really like it that cold. But the Janeiro Procumbens will actually still live, so I kept mine alive now going on 2 years. It's doing quite well. And I covered in the wintertime when we dipped, and only this winter, I think maybe 3 or 4 days, we dipped below 32 degrees, so otherwise it was fine. It kind of looked like heck or hell after we got out of winter, but once it started heating up, man, it started growing back, and now I'm in full force. Yeah, check me out on Instagram.com/growingyourgreens. I have a really good picture of my... I think that was yesterday's picture, my Janeiro Procumbens. So anyways, in Fort Collins, I would grow it in a container in a pot and grow it outside during the time you would regularly plant tomatoes and grow tomatoes outside and then bring it inside. The other thing I would do, if you want to grow it in the soil, grow it in the soil for the warm season and then at least a month before it gets cold, take cuttings off it, root them, and then have those growing inside all winter. And then once it warms up, then grow them outside so you could kind of can repeat that cycle. You know, I always continually have Janeiro Procumbens in my flood table. When I bump off leaves or I walk by and it breaks, I like, oh man, I'm not gonna compost this. I'm gonna like put it in my flood table and root it in a pot and then they grow. Let's see here. So glad you're doing the live videos. Found out yesterday you could juice okra and eggplant. Have you tried either? So I have juiced okra. Watch out, it will choke you. It's so thick and slimy. But yeah, check my videos. I can't post a link here, but check my videos for juicing okra. It's crazy. And I haven't juiced eggplant. I don't think that sounds too fun. But what I will be doing is I will be marinating my eggplant. I'll be harvesting it, slicing it thin, marinating it, probably in like some coconut aminos, and then freeze drying it. And that's gonna be bad. Badass. Let's see here. So many questions coming in. Can you send me some links about acai, please? Actually, you know, I don't think I take acai powder, but I actually haven't grown it. There's only been a few farms that I've actually visited that are growing acai. How many memes until you see us? I don't know what a meme is. Let's see. Oh, yeah. I'm glad I could help so many people gardening. I'm just kind of reading the comments. So many comments coming in. Let's see. I don't know how many people are going. Let's see. Please do a video about acai. Yes. So I went it's on my goal. It's on my list to like make videos about all these weird things. And when I go to a cool farm that has acai, I will make a video. What's your feeling on global warming and growing? Is it possible to freeze dry weed? That's a quick yes. But on global warming, so I like to say climate change. I don't like to say global warming. I know, you know, people will jump over me for global whatever. But the climate is changing. I mean, don't deny the climate is changing. Now, the reason why the climate is changing, there's a lot of reasons, and I'm not really going to get into that. That kind of gets into politics. I'm just going to say that each person in their lives need to take an action to improve the situation, however you can. And if everybody did this, we'd have a different situation. You know, drive less, bike more, use more sustainable transport, produce your own energy, produce your own food so it doesn't have to travel. And I have a really good video on Earth Day, so watch that video. Actually, yeah, the other thing is, eat less or completely eliminate animal products because they are so energy intensive. So the freeze dryers sell for, because X Sugar Free is asking how much does the freeze dryers cost. So they sell for around $2,000 to $3,000. I will start to sell those on my Discount Juicers website really soon. I just finished the first video actually earlier this week, and I got to get them added, and then I'll start sharing about those. They are definitely more expensive. And yes, freeze drying is definitely better than a dehydrator. I'll be comparing a freeze dryer to the dehydrator. I mean, they each have their pros and cons, but the thing about the freeze dryer is they preserve more nutrition. So as you guys know, I'm really into like growing the most nutritious crops, but also when I preserve it, I want to keep the most nutrition in there. Freeze drying can keep up to 97% of the nutrients. Dehydration, you could lose like maybe half, 40 to 50% of the nutrients, which is kind of crazy. The other thing, the freeze-dried food is a lot more shelf-stable. So if there is a zombie apocalypse, if there is some kind of World War III, knock on wood or something, you can store the food for up to 25 years. The other thing is that because it takes all the moisture out, it's really light. So like when I travel, everybody, John, how do you eat when you travel? Because I know you eat all this vegetables and all this stuff. I could now freeze-dry like a soup or a salad and literally take it with me when I travel. It's so light, and then add water back to it, and it's basically just like eating a fresh salad with like 97% of the nutrients. So yeah, pretty amazing. Let's see, somebody says, Gen H, human poo, ? So I do have a video on using human manure, and I do not recommend using uncomposted human manure, very important. I don't know why everybody gets fascinated with your own poo. You know, I've already gone poo 3 or 4 times a day. It's been really fast. I know you guys probably didn't need to know that, but people are talking about poo. I don't currently use my own human manure. It kind of gets reused somewhere else. But if you do use it, it should be properly composted. Most important thing, check out my video on human manure. My friend grew human with his human manure that he properly composted after years. You know, cabbages that were way bigger than actually cabbages grown on cow manure. Now, why is this? Why is human manure better than cow manure? Well, it's because you're probably eating better than the cows, so the remnants of your manure has more nutrients, and plus, you know, it's what you're eating, but also what you're not eating. So you're not eating chemically contaminated GMO foods that most cow manures and other manure products may have, and hopefully, you know, if you're eating a good diet, you're not going to have any kind of E. coli contamination in your manure. That being said, you know, human manure can be quite pathogenic, quite toxic, so you need to treat it properly. How about regular freezing fruits and vegetables? How much nutritional loss is after freezing? Yeah, so freezing fruits and vegetables picked at their peak ripeness is great. Once you freeze, you basically lock in the majority of the nutrients, unless you started pre-cutting it first, then you're exposing it to oxidation. Quick freezing would be best, so put in the freezer and just chill it down to instantly freeze it. So actually, if you want to get really extreme, you could get like the liquid nitrogen and dunk things into liquid nitrogen to freeze it instantly. So now you have minimal loss during the freezing process. Now the problem with the freezing is, okay, so the freezing keeps a lot of the nutrients. The problem is the nutrients are lost once you unfreeze. So once you unfreeze, because the freezing process broke cell walls, once you start to unfreeze it, now the cell walls are broken and now the nutrients start to dissipate. So that's why I like under a freeze dryer, you literally freeze dry, it freezes to like minus 40 degrees, and then only under vacuum, which then under vacuum you can have only minimal, if any, oxidation. Under vacuum, it's sucking off the moisture, so you're not going to have a loss. Now under regular freezing, and then you take it out, you take your bowl of strawberries that you froze, so you got locked in good nutrition because maybe you did in liquid nitrogen, and then you put in your freezer in deep freeze, not into your regular fridge that's going through a defrost cycle all the time. So get a dedicated freezer in your garage. Costco actually has a good one. It's $139 for 7.1 cubic feet. I've been eyeing those lately. But to modify to store my vegetables fresh at like 35 degrees, but that's a different topic. But anyways, once you freeze your stuff, that's great. But now the problem is once you take the frozen food and then you go to eat it, whether you're gonna cook it or whether you're gonna leave it out on your counter to defrost and your strawberries defrost and now you have thawed out strawberries, most of the nutrient losses from what I've seen are actually in the defrosting process, because the defrosting process is slow and you lose a lot of the nutrients. So it'd probably be best to defrost them under vacuum and then take them out of that and then eat them fast or just freeze dry them. Or the other thing is, if you are taking thing out of the freezer and you want to maximize the most nutrition, defrost them super fast or use them quickly. So I would just throw them in the blender, blend them up, and then drink it right then and there under vacuum. Actually, that's probably the best way to eat your frozen food, is to unthaw them out in the blender with other liquids under vacuum. All right, so that was a long answer. Can you make a video about natural cosmetics if you have any experience? Sorry guys, I do not have any experience with natural cosmetics. There's plenty of girls on YouTube that probably do that. Although I will have an episode on my skincare routine, which is actually quite important. Let's see, thoughts on Gerson method. So yeah, the Gerson therapy. I think the Gerson therapy, a lot of people that have uncurable illnesses get into the Gerson therapy. I sell a lot of juicers for people that have the Gerson therapy. And I think if you need something to try to find some kind of systematized approach, if you do have some kind of crazy disease that the doctors basically give up on you, I think it's prudent to use. With everything in life, there's things I agree with on the Gerson therapy and there's things that I don't agree with. And I'll just leave it at that because this is my gardening channel. What about sun drying? So yes, I could sun dry things here. And the thing about sun drying is, in my opinion, not that good. Now shade drying is better, but sun drying is not that good. Sun drying, you're getting extra basically heat and solar radiation, which is basically oxidizing and can cause burn on the food. And so you want to do it in a shade drying. But nonetheless, even comparing shade drying or sun drying, like real sun, compared to freeze drying, there's no match. Freeze drying is still, nutrition-wise, way better. Of course, sun drying is free. Freeze dryers cost a lot of money and also use a good amount of energy. So it's energy intensive, because my freeze dryer has been running on average about 48 hours for one batch of freeze-dried fruit, say jackfruit. But it's saving me a lot of money. So the freeze-dried jackfruit, it sells for around $50 a pound of freeze-dried jackfruit if you had to like buy it, and it's really rare that you could even find it. And so I make basically I got a medium freeze dryer currently. In one whole batch, I make about a pound of freeze-dried jackfruit, which takes 48 hours, and that's basically $50 worth of jackfruit, like if I had to buy it. But it's also, I think, higher quality than the stuff you'd buy. And then the jackfruit cost me $5, to fill it. And, pretty soon I'll be freeze-drying, like, all my peppers that I'm growing, which I have so many peppers this year. And, you cannot put a price on storing your own freeze-dried peppers on, like, the high-quality peppers that I grow. Let's see here. I've never seen you live. Cool. Good to see you. Go vegan. That's their name. It's probably also good to eat more plants. Let's see. May the forest be with you. I'm a rogue one. I like that. Do you grow chas trees? If you do, can you give me some tips on growing that type of tree in California? I don't. Let's see here. I don't know everything, so I will say that. I get a lot of questions like this. Hambo04. Love to see a video on wormeries, cultivating them, which species is best, etc. So wormeries, is that like cultivating worms? I do have a few episodes on that. Check my videos, my past episodes. I try to visit places that, if I don't do everything myself, I guess I just like go out and find people that are doing cool stuff and I make videos so I could share that info with you. Then I could kind of learn a little bit and you could learn a little bit at the same time. Let's see here. Your PC is overloaded. Yeah, I mean, it's sitting here in the 100 degree weather sun. So, I have a PV system that produces more power than I use now. That's why I'm looking at freeze-dryer service to put added value. Excellent. Yes, I'm going to get a PV system myself. And actually, it's good that I'm actually using the freeze-dryer because it's going to up the electricity that I use, because they will only allow you to have a PV system or a photovoltaic or solar system up to the amount of electricity you use and not over it. So actually, it's been good. I have an electric car and now the freeze dryer that's running more. I'm using more electricity. And so now my PV system can be more because it's basically gonna fit how much I'm using. His PC is overheating, yes. Let's see here. 500,000 subscribers, yes. Can you please send me some info about it? I don't know, let's see here. Scroll down or up. Let's scroll up a little bit. Freeze-dry manure for the apocalypse. Cardboard contains glues. Let's see. About sun drying. Let's go up. I composted my shorts. How often should I apply Dr. Bronner's and neem mixture for whiteflies? You know, so actually I don't apply Dr. Bronner's and neem mixture for whiteflies anymore. I said a little bit earlier in this live stream that I just am spraying water on them like every day. And then I'm using that other product that I showed a little bit earlier, the Dr. Zahn's stuff. So I've actually have sprayed this, but this is a non-persistent organic pesticide that basically dissipates once it dries out. And actually will not even work in full sun. So there's some negatives, but that's, in my opinion, positives. I think the good thing would be to call up Rincon Vitova and get some beneficial insects that will keep your bad insect populations under control. Like I said before previously, I have released over 50 praying mantis egg sacs. Each egg sac can contain up to 100 to 200 praying mantises, and they're just really cool to watch. And so they're gonna do all my bug control for me. And actually, it's really crazy. Like this year, normally I have problems with like hornworms, tomato hornworms, and usually they eat my tomatoes. And I don't really mind them eating my tomatoes, my plants, but it really pisses me off when they eat my pepper plants. Tomatoes grow pretty quick, so yeah, like they'll recover for the most part. But my peppers, they grow a lot slower. And so luckily I haven't had any tomato hornworms. So yes, I have been having the praying mantis. Maybe they eat the little caterpillar things or whatever. But the other thing, I have been irregularly spraying with the BT to help out, to actually act as a preventative. Let's see. The other thing is on the white flies, smush them with your finger. Let's go down to the bottom here. I don't know if this is still working. Let's see. Do you still grow cannabis? I've never grown cannabis, for the record, in recent years. Now, when I was in college, I did, but I don't grow cannabis. I haven't grown any cannabis for, since I was in college, which is many years ago. but that being said, if it was legal federally, I would grow it. Let's see here. When was the last time you ate at McDonald's? I can't remember. I mean, I haven't eaten. I stopped eating red meat in 1990. So probably at that point, pretty much, I didn't eat McDonald's because I really didn't eat chicken McNuggets. So it's probably been around since then. Such a random question. Yeah, but I mean, I'll go into McDonald's, you know, I'll use their bathrooms and I'll use their Wi-Fi. So if you see me at McDonald's one time sitting down, don't like, John Kohler, he's eating in McDonald's. No, I'm using their Wi-Fi and pissing in their toilet. Let's see. Any plants that will help with skin conditions? It depends on the type of skin condition, but I would say that it's not necessarily any plant particularly, but I would say it's your overall lifestyle. I think the thing I would try, I think the aloe vera, I think that's very good for your skin. The other thing that's super good for your skin, actually, for most skin conditions, actually, because I've had some problems with skin conditions. Like, I had this weird rash. It was actually after I went to this hotel in Chicago, right? I had this rash on my skin, and it, like, wouldn't go away. I, like, tried colloidal silver and all these things, and, like, nothing helped. And it's like, man, this freaking weird hotel bed had some fungus or some crap in there. So then I started using Noni lotion. So Noni, oh my God, grow some Noni if you guys can. It's a tropical plant. I mean, it tastes horrid, but like they make this Noni, 100% Noni lotion. Actually, I was at the farm in Kauai, but they didn't know who I was and they didn't want me to film that time. So that kind of sucked because I would really have loved to bring you that episode to share with you guys the power of the Noni. Let's see here. See, trying to go down on the. I heard Pam Mace took out banana trees because they require tons of H2O. Yes, I hope to visit Pam Mace down in Arizona. You know, I know Jake and Pam broke up, and I don't, you know, everybody has their side of the story, and I'm not going to take sides. I'm just there to share how the garden's doing and share what she's doing with people because I think, you know, she's taking care of basically Jake's and her place now, and she's still selling the moringa seeds and she still has her seed boxes and all that. How many hours do you usually sleep? It depends. I get as many hours of sleep as my body wants. So I go to bed when I'm tired generally, and then I wake up whenever. So that could be between 6 and 8, but generally it's more like 6. Let's see here. Have you heard of Vermis Terra worm castings and their worm tea? I have not. Let's see here. What containers are safe to grow organic? I would say like clay pots, you know, a wood box. Those are good. But I mean, even if the container isn't organic, because I don't think they certify containers organic, like I wouldn't really be concerned so much about that. I'd be more concerned about not the container being organic, but the soil that you're planting is being grown organically in good, non-contaminated soil. Your laptop needs an ice pack. You're right, I do have some inside. I don't know, I'll probably look at this video later and be like, oh my God, it's totally crazy. Let's see here. I made compost tea, it didn't foam up. Does that mean it's not gonna work? Yeah, sometimes it doesn't foam, that's all right. Lag. Let's see here. Oh, I got a super chat. Thanks, Chris B. Is it possible to grow vegetables inside besides microgreens? So the answer is, depends on your lighting, right? So yes, you can grow things inside besides microgreens. So herbs, I would grow herbs first inside. Oh, look, there's a praying mantis that came up on my screen. He's a little baby, he's so cool. But yeah, I would grow greens inside under lighting. You don't need to get any fancy, expensive lights. You know, just a standard shop light. Actually, I think I saw them on clearance or on sale at Costco. Just LED shop lights. If you're growing greens or herbs, those are the best things because herbs are really nutritious. The other thing I would grow is greens. You know, it wouldn't be my best choice to be growing like tomatoes or other things inside. If you are grow small like cherry tomatoes and small pepper fruits. But no, like, big fruits, they take a lot more, light energy than would be possible. But, you know, I just like to grow stuff outside. It's more natural. You got the sun, and it's like a lot more easier because growing things in a pot, even if it's outside, you know, the pot is basically a limited or modified environment. You know, growing in the earth is the best, in my opinion, or growing in a raised bed connected with the earth, because you have a lot more, the nature takes care of itself. But in a pot, it's more controlled, and I don't know. I'm not a big fan of growing in pots, but I am growing a lot more in the pots this year. So yes, can grow vegetables inside. Focus on herbs and leafy greens. Let's see here. Come to Dallas, North Carolina. So it's on my list. Do I drink green tea? I do not drink green tea. Sam, I am. No. I don't drink green tea. It's rare that I drink any actually kind of tea. I mean, unless I'm traveling. And there's like really nothing else. Because when you get tea, generally they're filtering the water. And then I'll cool it down because I don't like to eat anything that's hot. Oh, good. Kip and Jake, I'm glad it's not lagging for you. But I like to eat a matcha tea powder. So matcha tea powder is basically tea leaves that are ground up. So I'm getting the whole leaf instead of just the extracted water from the leaf and the nutrients that leach off the tea leaves. And actually, I'm growing my own tea plants. And the update on the tea plants is it was on winter watering cycle, which is like once a day. And then it got hot. And then I didn't change the winter watering cycle. So I think I lost one or two of them, which really sucks. They were expensive. Mad lag on my end. All right. Let's see. Seeds I bought from you, what survived? Couldn't see that. Me and my wife are planning to sell our property and go off grid, and this is because of your videos. So if it does not work, we'll blame you, John. All right, Adam. Hopefully it works. Be smart about it. I often pee outside, but stray can be very acidic. Should dilute if possible. Yes. So here's a thing you guys don't know about me. I'll share it. When I wake up in the morning, the first thing I do is come out to my garden to kind of like see how things are going. I look at the temperature, see how hot it is. Today when I got up today at 10. It was already like 100 degrees outside. And the first thing I did when I came outside is I looked at my garden, but then I peed. So every day I'll pick like a different fruiting plant. Today actually it was a pepper. Some days I'll pee underneath my tomatoes. And I don't dilute my pee. That being said, for most people, it'd probably be prudent to dilute it. I haven't had any issues with that. But also the other thing that you don't know about me is that I stay very hydrated. Before I go to bed and right after I wake up, I drink 32 ounces of liquid. Lately, upon awakening, I've been drinking celery juice, actually. Definitely not the best tasting juice, straight celery juice. And then at night, generally, I'll have like some cucumber juice. Green tea is bad. It's the highest source of fluoride in any plant. All right, so I mean, what I'd like to say, not Dave saying that, I like to say that, you know, I think nature needs to be in balance, right? And in nature's balance is, I think things can be all right. You know, I don't eat my green tea leaves or eat matcha tea powder every day. If I'm lucky, maybe I do that once a week, maybe a couple times a month, you know, but I like to have a varied diet. And in if we have a varied diet and we're not like eating kale every day, which kale could be bad too, I don't think these things are issues. And in every food, whether, you know, in tea, fluoride might be high, but then the ECGC or other phytonutrients are also high. So, you know, I think we need to have a more balance in our lives and not be so extreme, like good, bad, right, wrong. Think good, better, best is what I like to teach. All right. Let's see. Anything on kratom? So I have looked into that. I hope to make a good episode on that one day. I did visit a place that where I think I talked about that in passing, but no. Yeah, coast of Maine is awesome. Yes, I bet it is right now. Really cool in Maine. It'd be a nice place. If you started Malabar spinach this summer, oh yeah, I have a cool episode on starting Malabar spinach from seed or from basically transplants. Super important. Let's see. Some of us don't have a choice. I only have concrete yard, but I'm growing 20 different veggies and fruits in 6 meters squared, not white fly in pot growing or carrot fly. Let's see here. Can you recommend a good book on the raw food lifestyle? Yes. So go to Amazon.com and look up the author Karin, K-A-R-I-N, Dina. And that's the best book on raw foods because it's, you know, a more balanced approach, in my opinion. So that'd be that. And then I'd actually also recommend my Growing Your Greens recipe book for recipe ideas. Most raw food recipe books are horrid. They're things I wouldn't really want to eat. They may taste good, but they're really not written from a health perspective, in my opinion. And so my book is written from more of a health perspective, and that's at gygbook.com. I know some of you guys tried to purchase that within the last week, and here's the thing. The thing is, it's a complicated story, but I'll share with you guys since we're doing a live thing. The thing is, the GYG recipe book was basically, like, when Lauren and I got together, which we are now no longer together, like, that was supposed to be, like, her project, and she was going to make all the income off that to kind of, you know, be her contribution so that she could live. And then we broke up, so now that whole deal is kind of messed up. But she sells all the books. She keeps all the money for all that up to a point. Then we're going to have to start splitting it or something because she has invested thousands of hours to put it together. But she had a problem with her PayPal for, like, the last week, but it's fixed. So it's 4:20 right... Oh, it's 4... Oh, my God, you're kidding me. It's 4:20 right now. It's 4:21 now, but... let's see. What is your main staple meals? So my main staple meals are fruits and vegetables. So for today, I woke up, I had 32 ounces of celery juice, and then I had 32 ounces of watermelon juice. That's all I've eaten today, and it's already 4. I got up at 10. So I don't like to really eat too much early. I'm getting hungry, and actually after this, I'm gonna eat some a fruit meal. So I was able to get some fresh, locally grown, fresh picked, apricots, and so I'm gonna probably eat that next. And then for dinner, I'll probably have like a big salad of just like things in my garden, you know, salad or soup out of my garden. So that's in my recipe book. You'll see some of the things that actually I eat, because the recipes in the book are things I actually make. Let's see, my thing keeps let's see here. You are invited if we succeed on our off-grid farm. Well, I like to go if I'm in your area, I will stop by whether you succeed or not, because if you don't succeed, there are things to learn from and to teach people. So that's always good. Oh, so if someone invited you for a party such as Thanksgiving dinner, what do you eat? That's a good question. So yes, I am on a special diet, which is based around fruits and vegetables. So I don't eat a standard fare at Thanksgiving. Luckily, usually Thanksgiving takes place at either my family's or my partner's family. At present time, I don't have a partner. And then we will bring our own things. So we'll bring our own things, and other family members will bring their things, and they'll eat their things, and we'll eat our things, and sometimes they'll eat our things, but generally I don't eat their things. So, all right, let's see here. Go down to the bottom here. All right. What about fermented piss? That's a good question. So I don't like to ferment my pee. I think it kind of goes nasty. And if you did ferment it, I would definitely, if it had been sitting around a while, I would definitely water it down really well and then, you know, spread it around your garden. Like, I like to just use it straight, because once it starts sitting around, I don't know what's really happening in there. All right, let's see here. What are the questions? All right, I'm kind of getting hungry here. I don't even know how long we've been on here either. One of these days, I got to figure out more about this live streaming stuff here. Oh, somebody else did a super chat. Sorry, I didn't see it earlier. Tracy Alexander. Oh, how often should I apply Dr. Barnes and neem oil mix for white flies? Oh, good, good. I answered that question, even though I didn't even know it was a super chat. So up to 189 people watching now. Oh yeah, we've been going, actually, have we been going since like maybe almost an hour? That's crazy. All right, I'll take a couple more questions, then I actually got to run today, and stay tuned for a new video tonight. I have a video where I interview a native bee expert, actually, so we could get you guys to attract the native bees to your gardens, so you guys can get higher levels of pollination, and more importantly, help nature out, right? Because so many people do not consider nature and helping the other earthlings on our planet, whether they are birds, the bees, or the animals, or otherwise. All right, so let's see. So my pop-up chat window is right here. All right, you and Lauren broke up. Yes, we broke up. It's a long story. I can't really say much. She likes to keep things private. I will say that we are on different paths and we want different things. You know, I do want to have a family, and she's not sure if she wants to have kids. That's probably one of the main things. Plus, I'm not thinking the farming lifestyle is for her, you know. That's just what it is. That's all I'll say to that. Go vegan. My name is Lauren. Hey, wait, are you single? let's see. Nutritarian diet and your thoughts on Dr. Joel Fuhrman. So if you watch my other YouTube channel, my Discount Juicer channel, I just interviewed Dr. Fuhrman and just was with him actually 2 weeks ago. And I think probably he has the best approach to any diet that's out there. You know, he's pretty open about a lot of things, although he's strict on some things, which was cool. But I definitely would recommend him above all other plant-based doctors if you guys are, you know, wanting to make some dietary changes. You know, he has many books. He's been on PBS. He has the most solid approach. So actually, I have my own approach, but then I incorporate many things that Dr. Fuhrman teaches into my diet to make my diet better. See, somebody asked, how old are you? So I don't disclose my age at present time, but it says, does your diet slow the aging process? So I will unequivocally not reveal my age, but I will equivocally say that my diet has significantly slowed or reduced the aging process. I hung out with my friend from college. We went to college and we're in the fraternity together. And we hung out, like actually we saw each other. He came to my garden yesterday, so I gave him a little tour. And then we went to a show on the Strip the previous night. And he's my age and he looks significantly older. So I will say that. And basically it's a nutritarian diet. You want to eat less calories, but get all your nutrient needs met. And unfortunately the standard American diet, McDonald's and junk foods, processed foods, and even animal foods. Yes, I'm going to say that again. Animal foods, those are high caloric foods with little micronutrients. The micronutrients are things like the zeaxanthin, the lutein, you know, the beta carotene, the lycopene. These are basically non-caloric nutrients in the foods that are super critical for us for anti-aging and for health, you know, for disease prevention. And so these are the things that we need to eat the most, and that's why I'm really into my vegetables. The leafy green vegetables and other vegetables are the most nutrient dense, have the most phytonutrients and least calories. Meanwhile, most of Americans are eating high calorie foods that have little nutrients. And yeah, I know some of you guys out there eat meat, and I'm gonna say that the honest truth is the meat has some nutrients in there, absolutely. It also has some anti-nutrients in there, you know, like persistent proteins that our bodies don't handle, that cause immune response within us. But more importantly to me is that they lack the phytonutrients. They lack the anti-aging and disease-preventing nutrients. So when you eat more meat and you don't eat enough vegetables, you're missing out on the good stuff. So if you do choose to eat meat, which I don't choose to eat meat, I do not think it is required. If you are going to eat meat, eat very little portions and raise it and kill it yourself, which I'm going to say that publicly. And I will say that you need to eat lots of vegetables. So most people eat a lot of meat and little vegetables. You need to eat a lot of vegetables, a little bit of meat. And I think people have lost a connection with their food, whether that's the meat they're eating or whether that's the vegetables or whether that's a processed food that just is made in a factory. You don't know how it's made. You don't know what was done to that food. You don't know what was done to that animal. Raise the animal, kill yourself if you want to eat. I'm not like encouraging people to do that. I'm saying if you want to eat meat, that's the best way to do it. But on the other hand, we do not need to eat meat to be healthy. I have lived meat-free now for 23 years, you know, since 1995 when I started my fruit and vegetable-dominated diet. All right, let's see. We're going to take two more questions, and then I got to run. So Go Vegan says he is 86 years old. That's not accurate. All right. Let's see here. Why would you not say your age? That's just a personal thing. I don't want my age to be known.
T
You eat fish. I do not eat any meat. So meat would be considered anything that comes from an animal and their flesh, or human flesh for that matter, which could be also meat. I don't drink any dairy products or eat any dairy products knowingly, although I was at a health food trade show a couple years and it said raw ice cream and I had some, and then I found out it was actually raw dairy ice cream, which was not, which I, you know, ate by accident. But I don't think we need dairy products either, although I was at the freeze-dried company and they did have some freeze-dried milk, human milk actually, that I was interested in trying, but they wouldn't give it to me. All right, let's see. Fish or seafood? So I do eat seafood, right? So the seafood I eat is actually, I eat vegetables of the ocean or seaweeds. Those are another, you know, food that I think should be eaten in greater quantities than they are, although the oceans can be contaminated, so you do need to watch it. So I wouldn't eat a sea vegetable-based diet, although I do like to eat plant-based, land-grown vegetables with some seaweeds mixed in. Saw your Nutribullet hack, Vitamix hack. Yeah, so I've tried converting the Vitamix to a vacuum blender. It wasn't successful, so there's a solution coming out hopefully later this year. Let's see. Best way to make tomato cages. Depends if you want to go cheap. So, I mean, the best, easiest way is just get some of the, welded wire fencing that comes in rolls at Home Depot and just get the tallest ones you can and just roll them into circles, or you could get the, it's called the concrete remesh, which is what they put in their sidewalks, and then just curl that up. Super simple, super easy. How do you deal with the heat? I wear a hat. No. So I actually have a shade cloth in there and then proper watering. Now, actually half my garden has shade cloth and the other half actually doesn't. And the other half is still doing great. So actually I will have a tour video showing you guys the half that has shade and the half that doesn't, and actually both do well. Anyways, and then appropriate watering. So not just watering once a day. That would, if the plants are hot, they're getting wilted out, I like to give them some water, but on the ground, so that they could basically, like if we get hot, dehydrated, we need to drink water. Our plants need to basically get water so they could do their, run water through their little plant bodies and evaporate the water, or called transpire. What about beer, vodka? I do not drink personally, except if it's a kombucha and it's maybe has a little bit of fermentation, but I don't even like to drink kombucha. All right. Is kombucha good for your gut? So, good, better, best. Kombucha is definitely better than a soda, but in my opinion, I would rather drink some jicama juice or some kind of vegetable juice, which I think would be more beneficial. Let's see. Do you pee on your plants? Is there a difference between my peed on plants and non-peed on plants? I pee on my plants, not on them, but out on the soil right underneath them. And I don't really keep track if there's a difference. Maybe one day I'll have to do that. Let's see. Can you grow ocean plants in a tank outside? Yes. So that's one of my goals, is to make a video on how you guys grow seaweeds inside your house in a fish tank. There are plenty of good, people that are into aquariums and stuff that grow seaweeds for their fish. But the next level is taking that and growing seaweeds for yourself, which is really cool. Do you eat veggie cheese and faux meats made out of soy? No, do not eat veggie cheeses that are highly processed and faux meats made out of soy. They are processed food and probably as bad or worse for you as eating meat, in my opinion. We want to eat whole foods. So if I do eat some kind of quote-unquote cheese, it's something that I fermented myself. I could soak some nuts, drain them out, blend it up under the vacuum blender, and then add some cultures in there, and then basically it'll ferment on their own. But even a lot of vegan nut cheeses now are adding a lot of fillers, stabilizers, coconut oil, and all these other crazy things. All right, so last question today. Just me, you're the lucky winner. I remember watching a video with you starting something in Puerto Rico. Any updates? So yeah, so I did. I was down in Puerto Rico looking for property with a friend of mine, and it was my intention to get some property down there, and we just went and checked out a lot of places, but we never found anything concrete. And then the hurricane happened. So that kind of like really set the plan back. Since I do want to buy with my friends down there, they are going to wait like 3 years before they do anything, so that kind of put that off. Plus, the other thing that's really important for me to get a farm, like, in my head, this is my idea in my head, like, I don't want to get a farm, like, myself. As much as I want to farm myself, I'm not getting a farm by myself. I'm not getting a farm myself. And that might sound strange to you, but here's the thing. Like, I want to get a farm with my partner, who's going to be a female, not a male. And so, you know, I want to bring in my girlfriend, or hopefully my wife, or fiance, or whatever, and I want us to find land together, buy the land together, decide on what we're planting together, have a family together, work the farm together. And so, like, it's not like my place, she's moving in into my space, because when that happens in a relationship, that hasn't really worked well for me in the past. Although it is a good test to see how you will get along in the future. But we'll have our own space together and build a family, build a farm together. So that's kind of like my, I mean, I want to say pipe dream, but hopefully it's going to become a reality one day. So, do you take any vitamins, or does your dad provide all your needs? I'm still answering questions. Oh my God. So, I like to take as few additional nutrients as possible. That being said, I do take vitamin B12. Off season, I do try to take some vitamin D. I have videos on my other YouTube channel, OK Raw, where I kind of go more into supplementation, which you will get a more complete answer. I also take EPA and DHA, which I think is critical for people that are eating a plant-based diet to get, even maybe meat eaters that are not eating enough fish and not getting enough of that in their bodies. It's super important for, you know, your brain. Miyoko's is a cream of the crop, referring to nut cheeses. Yes, they taste good, but some of the ingredients and some of the formulations, you know, they don't meet my specifications. So, any chance you'll buy in South Florida instead? Maybe. Anyways, I gotta run, guys. I'm so sorry. I wish I could stay on here forever. My laptop's overheating, and actually, I still got gardening to do. I gotta run irrigation to a few pots I got, and oh, I gotta transplant my moringa up pot size because I just started some seeds. So, thanks for watching me, and hope the video wasn't too laggy for you guys. I'll try to improve in the future, and stay tuned for an upcoming episode I'm posting later tonight after the sun goes down, after I'm inside from my gardening, on the native bees. Yeah, so take care. Good to see you guys. Adios. And, make sure you thumbs this video up if you guys can. I don't know how that works on live chat. Thumbs it up if you liked it. I'll do more live chats in the future for you guys. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below if you're not already subscribed, and follow me online. I come out with videos on this YouTube channel every 3 to 4 days. You never know where I'll share what I'll be learning on my YouTube channel. Be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge. I like to think I'm a walking encyclopedia, but even better than me, which I can't remember entirely.